Yeah, turning on the microphone really helps.
Yes.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the Manhattan Church of Christ. We're so glad you're here on this Labor Day weekend. Welcome to those who are joining us online as well. We're so happy to have you with us. Let's start out our morning with the joy of the Lord.
The joy of the Lord will be my strength. I will not falter, I will not faint. He is my shepherd, I am not afraid. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord.
There, if you have new contact information, we would love to have that. And if you have any prayer requests, we'd also like to know those as well. And when you come up for communion, you can just place them right here on the table. Our call to worship today and the inspiration for the song that we'll sing with Jason right after this is taken from Psalm 34, 8 through 22. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the one who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord. You, his holy people, for those who fear him lack nothing. The lions may grow weak and hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, my children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and his ears are attentive to their cry. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil, to blot out their names from the earth. The righteous cry out, and the Lord hears them. He delivers them from all their troubles. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. The righteous person may have troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. He protects all his bones. None of them will be broken. Evil will slay the wicked. The foes of the righteous will be condemned. The Lord will rescue his servants. No one who takes refuge in him will be condemned. Let us pray. Dear Lord and Father, Savior, Messiah, Holy Spirit, thank you for this day and this time we have together as your children. We take refuge in you. Thank you for delivering us from our troubles and giving us hope and strength in this world. Clear our hearts now so that we can truly praise you and seek your face this morning. In your son's precious name we pray, amen. All right. We're gonna sing the good song, because this is a good song.
I'm gonna sing it by you. Good morning, everyone. This is a favorite song of us, for those of us up in youth church. And I think we're just going to have to use this mic, Jacob, because I don't know if the other thing is working. But here we go.
The lions may grow weak and hungry. Lions may grow weak and hungry. Lions may grow weak and
hungry, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. The lions may grow weak and hungry.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest faith, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid, Christ's good, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness fills it,
and we just have to believe in that.
God moves in a mysterious way. His wonders to perform. He plots his footsteps in the sea and rides upon
Good morning. My name is Kevin Birchfield. I've been thinking a lot this week. Joanna and I, at the 1st of August, kind of celebrated being in New York for 4 years now. So, you know, it got me thinking a lot about the journey we've been on and what we've gone through, and home a little bit and all kinds of things. So I was thinking a lot as I was preparing for the community prayer, and it reminded me of a story. So at our house back in Euless, Texas, where we lived before we moved here, there was this really ugly bush out in front of our house. And we hated this bush. And every time I cut the lawn and trimmed the hedge, there would be bees in it. I would get stung every time. It drove it absolutely crazy. So one Labor Day, we decided, that's it. The bush has got to go. So for 6 or 8 hours in the fun Texas heat, I sawed on it, I cut it, I burned it, I did everything I could to this bush to cut it down and get it below the dirt. Finally had it below the dirt after the end of the day, covered it over, and I was like, fine, bush is gone. Went back to Texas to visit my family in July, and I happened to drive by our old house, and now it's almost as tall as the roof again. And so it just, no matter what I did to that bush, I could not get rid of it. And it just, it reminds me of why we do this. Because the reason I couldn't kill the bush is I could never get to the root system and pull it out. And I am frail. I am a sinner. I am weak. So one person can be defeated. One person's soul can and spirit can be crushed. I can be devastated by illness or loss or pain or anxiety or depression or whatever struggle I have in life. But in Matthew 18, we're told, where two or more gather in my name, I am there. When I'm alone and I pray, I have the Holy Spirit that intercedes for me. But this morning, God himself is in our midst right now because we're going to go to his throne and pray. And that is so powerful. So we may not always get the answer on this earth that we want for the prayers that I'm about to lift up. But God is here this morning. He is holding us this morning. He is sitting beside you this morning. His arm is around you for whatever it is you're going through, whether we're publicly going to pray for it or whether you're struggling in silence. And we are stronger because we are the root system of God's family. And when one is weak, the other is strong to keep that root system together. So let's take these requests that we have before the throne room of God this morning. Loving and gracious God, we come before you today with hearts full of gratitude and hope. We seek your guidance and your comfort, and we want to lift these requests from this church family before your throne this morning. We pray for your presence to be felt in every need, every heart, every home. Father, help everyone to feel you sitting beside them with your arm around them, loving you and loving them in the spirit that you give us. Lord, we ask for your blessings on our families, especially as this new school year begins. Please be with our children, our students, those that are our educators as they navigate through this year. Guide them, strengthen them. We pray for the young adults that are in college, going through their struggles. For those that have finished their college journey and are starting their careers, help them to find purpose and joy in their endeavors and in their work. Father, we lift up Elsa Kaiseris and her family. We pray that you grant health and healing to her husband, Miguel, and bring comfort to Aileen as she is in hospice care for COPD. May your peace surround them in this time of need. We pray for Melanie Hyman's son, Ethan, as he's monitored for a heart condition. Lord, bring him strength and healing and provide comfort to this family as they walk this uncertain path together. Father, we want to ask you to lift up the Gerlopedi family and ask for your guidance in Guru's job search as a postdoctoral research fellow in chemistry. May opportunities open up for him and may he find a position that aligns with his gifts and passions. We pray for Mary Joseph's siblings, Allworth, Austin, David, Aaron, and Valerine. May your love and protection be with them, and may they feel your presence in their lives each day. We want to lift up Elsa Lozanzo's friend Ursula and Julia. We ask for their health and well-being, and we pray for Elsa's faith in her family, that they may find strength and unity in you. We pray for Sandra Marquez's nephew Adonis and her brother-in-law Julio and her friend Kenia as they undergo We know you are mighty. You are able to do all things, and we ask for your comfort to surround them during this difficult time. Father, we lift up Marydell Stelzer as she recovers from her shoulder injury. Grant her patience and strength in her healing process, and may she feel your presence guiding her to recovery. We pray for Catherine Grega Albert and her stepson Tom, who's been diagnosed with stage 4 colon cancer and is undergoing chemotherapy. Be their refuge and strength, Lord. Grant Tom courage to face this treatment and surround Catherine and their family with your love and peace. Father, we ask to lift up Angel Rhea's mother, Juana. We pray for her health and healing, and we also pray for Angel's personal matters, his family, his ministry. Please have your wisdom and grace be with them in all things, Lord. And we acknowledge that there are many varied and other health concerns in this church family. We ask for your care for these good results. We ask for your healing hand to be on those who are suffering or in need. We ask for Emily's brother, Howard Lester, to be with him as he's in early stage Parkinson's. He's an elder at the Broad Street Church of Christ in LaGrange, Georgia. I pray that you will just be with him and be with Emily and surround her whole family with peace and love. Father, Joanna and I have a friend, Lucretia Phillips, who's recovering from cancer-related surgery in Texas. Be with her, heal her as she recovers from this surgery, and pray that she will be cancer-free and healed soon. Father, we also pray for the love of peace, joy in Christ to overcome the tyranny of the war and oppression and injustice that's going on in this world. Father, we know that your light can shine in the darkest places, and we pray that you will intercede in all these situations. Help us to be an instrument of peace in this world and show the world that there is a better way. And we ask your all of these things in the name of your mighty Son, Jesus Christ, who is our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Thank you so much, Kevin. Thank you. I know a bush like that, too. That was a great story. This next song, this is our song before communion. I love this song because it has so many descriptive terms about God. So as we sing through this, just take note of all these descriptive terms and names for God before the throne of God above.
Before the throne of God above, I am a strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hand, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands,
Good morning. My name is Allison Isbell, and I've been a member at this church for as long as Jason Isbell has worked here. I can never remember. 25 years. Wow, Jace. Amazing. So join me this morning as we engage in communion together. After this reading, we'll all come forward, greet one another, take some bread and juice, and then hold on to it, and in a moment we'll eat it together. Why are we invited to share a meal at Jesus' table each week? We are invited because Jesus didn't come for the strong, but for the weak, not for the righteous, but also for the sinners, not only for the self-sufficient, but also for those who are in need. To all who are tired and need rest, to all who are sad and long for comfort, to all who feel unimportant and wonder if God cares, to all who are weak and frail and wish for strength, to all who have made mistakes and need a Savior, Jesus welcomes you into his circle, embraces you as a part of his family, and sets a place at a table for you here. He is a great friend to sinners, a helper to his enemies, a protector of the vulnerable, and the forgiver of those run out of excuses. So join me now and come to the feast.
Sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, I love Jesus, and oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. Well, it tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfectly. Oh, and oh,
how
he's
I
so
love
wonderful
Jesus.
To
oh,
me.
How
he's
I love
so
Jesus.
Wonderful.
Oh, because he first loved me.
Well, it tells me of whose love in a heart can fill my deepest woe. Whose in sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Oh, and oh,
how I love Jesus.
And oh,
how I love Jesus.
Oh,
how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me.
Yes,
oh, how
he's so wonderful
Jesus.
To me.
Oh, how
he's
I love
so
Jesus.
Wonderful
to me.
How
because he first loved me.
Singing, oh,
oh,
how
I love
Jesus.
Oh,
how
I love
Jesus.
Oh,
how
I love
Jesus.
Because he first loved me.
Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, here by thy great help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood. Precious blood. Oh, that day when freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face. Clothed then in blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry.
Know me. I'm very social. So sorry. Let's pray together. Father, we are so grateful for this ritual that you established so many years ago that continues to bring us together in the midst of whatever it is that's happening in our weeks. And it reminds us, this simple act, we are not alone, that we are not alone, that we are not separate or far from you, but we are inextricably linked to you through the blood and body of Christ. And it also reminds us we are not alone in this big city, that we have this blessed community of people who love and care about us. And I just thank you, Father, for both of these things, the macro to the micro of our lives and the ways in which we are cared for and care for one another through this act together. We pray gratitude for the blood and body of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much, Allison. Thank you. We come to the portion of our service where we have the opportunity to give back to the work of the church here in Manhattan and around the world. There will be passing trays around, and you can also give online as well. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we come before you with hearts full of gratitude for your powerful presence and the incredible work that you do in our lives. We are thankful for your goodness and the countless blessings you bestow upon us. In our toughest times, you provide hope and the strength we need to carry out your will. Your unending love and care are always with us. As we present our offerings today, we ask that they be used to further the work of the church in your name, spreading your love and compassion to everyone. In your Son's precious name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Let's sing How Sweet, How Heavenly.
How sweet, how heavenly is the sight when falls the love of the Lord in one another's feast delight.
next weekend, next weekend, next weekend is our retreat. So if you have not registered, please register. We really need to get a count. We need to, you know, figure out rooming and things like that. So please just go online and register. We hope each and every one of you can come. I'm going to thank George in advance. He'll be leading our worship next week, and Angel will be preaching. So it'll just be a wonderful time of worship here as well if you can't come to the retreat. The Bible study Tuesday Word in Worship is Tuesday nights at 7:30. It's online, and weekly classes are studying prophetic books of the Old Testament. It's now underway. So explore scripture and bring questions. It's led by Tom Robinson. Cafe Wednesdays meets every Wednesday at 6 o'clock on the third floor. The topic is Proverbs. Families and children are welcome, and a light bite is included. So at this time, there's a teen fellowship. I knew this because I'm going to go up there and make it. So we have a fellowship lunch today. It's the first Sunday of the month. So come on up. We're having Italian. So it'll be a lot, really good. Oh, you have a question, Ngozi. Oh, yeah, problems registering for the retreat. I know that, talk to Jason. Jason's going to talk to me, yeah. And you already have. Okay, good. Thank you, good. If anybody has any trouble, just talk to Jason. So we'll hope to see you all upstairs on the fourth floor after service for our fellowship lunch. Let's stand and sing, We Are More Than Conquerors, and our children can be dismissed upstairs for children's worship at this time.
Strength is calm. You're the one who calls me on. You are the light. You are the light within my soul. Oh, your resurrection power burns like fire in my heart. When waters rise, I lift my eyes up to your throne. We are more than conquerors through Christ. We have overcome this world. Is risen from on high. Greater is he living in me than in the world. No surrender, no retreat. We are free and we're redeemed. We will declare over despair, you are the whole. We are more than conquerors through Christ. You have overcome this world, this life. We will not bow to sin or to shame. We are defiant in your name. You are the fire that cannot be tamed. You are the power in our veins, O Lord, our God, our conqueror.
Nothing is impossible. Every chain is breakable with you. We are victorious. You are stronger than our hearts. You are greater than the dark with you. We are victorious. We are more than conquerors through Christ. You have overcome this world, this life. We will not bow to sin or to shame. We are defiant in your name. You are the fire that cannot be tamed. You are the power in our veins, our Lord, our God, our conqueror. Our Lord.
Good morning. My name is Jennifer, and I'll be reading Romans chapter 8, verse 9 to 28. All of you, however, are not just in flesh, but rather in spirit, if in fact God's Spirit is dwelling in you. Now, if someone doesn't have the anointed king's spirit, they're not part of him. But if the anointed king is in you, although the body is dying, because of the impact of sin, the presence of the Spirit is life itself because of God's faithful righteousness. Now, if the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead is dwelling in you, then he who raised the anointed king from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who's making his home within you. So then, brothers and sisters, we don't owe any obligation to the flesh to keep on living lives determined by flesh. For if you're living a life determined only by flesh, you're only in the process of dying. But if you join with the Spirit in condemning to death the sinful practices of the body, you're going to truly live. For all who are being led through life by God's Spirit are God's sons and daughters. For you didn't receive a spirit of slavery that turns back again toward fear, but you received a Spirit who empowers our adoption as God's children, in whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself is bearing witness with our spirit, then we're children of God. Now, if we're children, we're also heirs, heirs who belong to God's family and fellow heirs with anointed King. If indeed we're suffering with him, so that we may also be glorified with him. For I don't consider that the sufferings of our time right now are worthy to be set beside the glory that's going to be revealed for us. For the eager expectation of all creation is breathlessly awaiting the revealing of the sons and daughters of God. For the creation of subjected to vain transitoriness, not by its own will, but because of one who subjected it based on hope, that even the creation itself will be set free from the slavery of its corruption into the freedom of the glory that belongs to the children of God. For we know that all of creation is sighing with us and suffering pains of childbirth with us until this moment. And not only that, but also ourselves, as we possess the first fruit of experiencing the Spirit. We're also still sighing in ourselves as we eagerly awaiting our full adoption as God's children, our redemption of the body from slavery. For in hope we were saved. Now when a hope is seen, it's no longer hope, for hope's for what they already see. But if we're hoping for what we don't yet see, then we're eagerly waiting for it with real fortitude. In the same way, the Spirit is helping just where we are weak, for we don't know what we should pray for, what's really needed. But the Spirit himself is interceding on our behalf with sighs that can't be put into words. Now, the one who searches the hearts knows the Spirit's very way of thinking, because it's in own accord with God's reality that intercedes on behalf of God's people. And we know that for those who love God, he works with them in all things towards what's good, for those who are called according to God's purpose.
I want to thank all of you for your presence here today. It's been a wonderful time of worship. I want to thank Jennifer just now for her beautiful reading of a long text, and as well for really appreciated Kevin's community prayer, especially the way he led us into it, and Allison's communion meditation. I think the sheets that are for the message today are being handed out. So if you have not gotten one, I hope you will get one. As we were just talking about it, we're getting right up to the edge of our retreat. And it's going to be fun. It's going to be good. It's going to be at a beautiful place, and we hope for good weather and hope that everything will go nicely for all of us. So I really, if you haven't registered, please do so. If you're thinking, oh, I just don't have the money right now to do it, register anyway and just let us know that you need to delay or you can't do anything about it at all, you just don't have the resources, you can still come. We would love to subsidize your presence there because it's more important to us to have everybody there and to share in that than a particular amount. And for if you can't come, then please be here this next Sunday and help George and help Angel as they lead the worship here next Sunday. 2 weeks ago, we began a three-part, three-message series that's leading up to our retreat. The retreat has as its general topic, life in the Spirit. And we've taken as a focus text something that's there on your sheet, just on the back, the very top of the back in that box there, the text from Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23, where Paul has been writing about the challenge of living life and the struggles of life, the internal struggles, and he talks about the flesh, that term that he often uses. And as everybody always says whenever they talk about that word in Paul's writings, he doesn't mean this stuff here, even though that's the word that he chooses to use. He's thinking of human life as we are limited, though, by the flesh. As I often say, you know, I look out and I see the world always through my eyes. I don't get to see it through your eyes. I see it with the limitations of my brain, my experiences, my background, and all of those things, not yours. That's the reason it's lovely to talk to each other and get to know each other, because we learn other points of view and other experiences of life and all of that. I have to deal with the problems that I have. And so my view of the world is always limited. And that means always also in some way or other distorted. I don't know the world as it appears to you, or certainly as it appears to God. And so I look out. So in a sense, it's not the sense that this is something bad, but that the limitations of us as human beings always lead us into a distorted view of the world. And the form that takes in so many situations for human beings is that we start, well, the way I like to picture it is that, I just from my own experience, you start thinking that the world revolves around you. And look, lo and behold, it does. The whole world revolves around me. You're just part of my world. Welcome to my world. But you aren't, are you? I'm just part of your world. That means that I have a built-in tendency toward self, toward self-aggrandizement, toward centering on myself. And that element, as it plays out in human life and human existence, messes up so many things. And Paul uses that to talk about the works of the flesh in Galatians 5. And mostly the things that he talks about are those things that produce conflict between peoples and other things as well. But then after talking about the actions, the works of the flesh, of me as I live in my own little capsule in the world, he talks also about the fruit of the Spirit. He talks about how the flesh and the Spirit go in different directions. And the famous passage and the one that we're using as a kind of focus point for our retreat is Galatians 5, 22 and 20 through 25. Instead of saying the actions of the flesh or the works of the flesh and the works of the Spirit, as though it were our works that we do, he talks about the fruit of the Spirit. the fruit of the Spirit, and he gives this list of words, is love, joy. You can look at that box. The fruit of the Spirit, the fruit that comes from the Spirit, love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. There's no law against things like these, he says. Those who are part of Jesus, the anointed king, the Messiah, that's the anointed king is a translation of the word Messiah or Christ. Those who were part of Jesus, the anointed king, crucified the flesh with its passions and desires, its covetous desires. If we're alive by spirit, let's walk step by step in line with spirit, Paul says. Well, after our first message was on Galatians 5, last week we went a different direction and looked at what Jesus has to say about the Spirit in the Gospel of John, especially in chapter 14, but also some other passages. And talking to the disciples about the Spirit, the helper, that as he was talking to them at the Last Supper and where he was going to be crucified the next day, not that they understood that, but he knew it, of course. And he talks about the fact that he is going to send to them the Holy Spirit, the parakletos, the paraclete, the helper, the counselor. And as we said last week, it's translated in different ways. But as you see him describe it, it also is, he says, I'm not going to leave you like orphans. I'm going to come to you. And then he talks about how the Father and I are going to come to you and make our abode, our home in you. And so we get a sense from Jesus' own words of how this talk about the Spirit is a talk about God as a whole and all that God does. So it has this understanding of us as human beings, creatures of God, children of God, and trying to understand all that God does in this remarkable way. And today we focus on Romans, the 8th chapter, which has got to be one of the most remarkable passages, an amazing text, on many different levels and including many different things. We're focusing in the message this morning on the kind of large central section of Romans 8, where it focuses on and talks about the Spirit and what the work that the Spirit does, as well as other things, because Paul is not just talking about the Spirit in Romans 8, but it does bring us to think about these things, and the way in which Paul talks about it is trying to help us to think into, the way I often put it is, into the reality of God, to overcome our guesses, so to speak, about God, to think about who God truly is as Father, as Son, as Holy Spirit, and to understand our lives within that reality, taking that seriously. Let me just mention one other thing that I've put back on the table back there. If you want to pick one up, I want to recommend it to you because I've put a lot of work in this over a number of years. It's on yellow paper to stand out. And I've titled it, What God Has Done For Us, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. But the subtitle maybe is a little bit more to the point. Paul's Letter to the Romans, Chapter 8. An expansive reading. It's a paraphrase of Romans chapter 8. The best that I can do in trying to pull together the broader, the wider meaning, expressing it with more and more language, because Paul writes in a very, very compressed style. And so it has in the column on the right-hand side, it has a regular translation. And then on the left-hand side, and this will let you see the difference, the left-hand side, it has the paraphrase of Romans chapter 8, the whole thing. So what we're going to do today is just the section from verse 9 through verse 28 of Romans 8. If you happen to want one even now, you can hold up your hand, and I ask Keith if he would mind handing some out, you can have a copy of this. I'm not going to read it right now, but I think you'll have to be the judge of it. It's the best that I can do as far as trying to go into this, because this passage, this chapter, is just so remarkable. It leads us, as I said again, into that vast reality of what God has done. We talk about spirituality, and so many people, when they hear that, they think of something that's within themselves, and that's all right. That's good, because we do have a transcendent nature, a spiritual nature in ourselves. But the thing that's sort of challenging when you go to the scriptures, whether you're listening to Jesus or whether you're listening to Paul, either one, it is not just about when Jesus talks to the disciples about the helper, the paraclete coming to them. He's not just talking about their spirituality that they can develop, but he really means it, that God is coming to be involved. I am coming, Jesus says, to stay with you, to be involved in your life. And so there is both this spirit of myself that's there, but that spirit of myself is often messed up in the way in which it looks at the world. But there is also the spirit of God that Paul talks about in our text today. And it is God's self-revelation. When you read, of course, from the scriptures, you know that the scriptures in the Old Testament, the New Testament too, are very definitely what one would call technically monotheistic. They believe in one God. But they also know, especially in the New Testament, that God is complex, as I often say. God's self-revelation unfolds in the whole scripture, and certainly in this text. One God shows the depth of that oneness in unexpected ways as you go through the scriptures. You watch through the Old Testament, you watch God interacting in various ways, in remarkably various ways, with Israel, and how Israel's story becomes part of the Word of God that comes to us in the Old Testament. But then in a far more focused way, God shows God's self in Jesus, one person about the size of any of us, who unites God and human beings, uniting those two together, bringing them together, and doing things because of that that could never be done in any other way. And then the topic from our text today that comes unfolding in Jesus' own experience, Jesus' own ministry, but then especially as Jesus talks about the coming of the Holy Spirit to the disciples, and then as that happens on the day of Pentecost in the Holy Spirit. So God is, as we think of as God, creator of heaven and earth, distant, but also coming in prophets and coming for judgment and dealing with people through the course of Israel's history. Then in this one person that blew the minds, if I can say it that way, of his own disciples, of uniting God with a human being. But then that one tells about the coming of the paraclete, the Holy Spirit. And there God is not just dwelling in the temple in Jerusalem above the Ark of the Covenant as it was in the Old Testament or in the Holy of Holies, but dwelling in us, dwelling in you. God choosing to unite God's self with you in some way that's sort of like Jesus being both God and human, but is also not, because we're much more of a mess than Jesus was. We're very much in flesh, but God nevertheless comes to live, to dwell in us, as Jesus pointed to it. And as our scripture text uses to highlight what this is about, it says that leads to us being able to speak to the God of the universe, great beyond imagination, as Papa, as Abba is the Hebrew name for God, a child's name for God. That implies that as children of God, we have free access. As it's often illustrated, you know, even the most powerful person, a king on the throne or a president of the United States or anybody, their kids can come in and play at their feet. And they don't have to ask permission and so forth. They have the free run of the office that some ambassador from another nation would give his right arm to have and so forth. Free access. Because there is this deep love, this belonging that goes together. So our text is in the middle of that passage in Romans 8 that connects to Galatians 5 with Galatians' reflections on the flesh and our limitations, but at the same time, the idea of God working in us, dwelling in us, and fruit coming from that, whether it's the fruit that we bear or the fruit that we are fed or what, however one takes the metaphor in all of this. It reflects on that flesh and our limited and distorted view of reality without God, but then on what God does. And so if you don't mind, as I often do, I want to just, because that this is the main thing, I want to read portions of our text again, and we just, that's what we're learning from. Romans chapter 8, verses 9 through 13 right now. It's on the front side of your sheet. All of you, and he's writing to the church in Rome, that he knows a lot of the people there because they've been working with him, and they've traveled to Rome since the politics there has allowed Jews and others that are tied to this Christian faith to come back to Rome. All the Jews had been kicked out of Rome. So he's writing to the church in Rome, and who are made up of Jews and Gentiles and all kinds of people there, and but are struggling with how do they stay together? What is it that unites them? And the kind of misunderstandings that they have. And so Rome, that gives Romans its thrust in the whole thing. And here he says, as he comes to this, all of you are not just in flesh. Rather, you're in spirit. But then notice these some ifs that follow. I've underlined them in your text. If, in fact, God's spirit is dwelling in you. Each of the ifs in some way or other points to what the gospel says. If you trust what God has done, what is proclaimed in the gospel, then this is the direction you go. So it's challenging both our understanding and our faith. You are not in flesh. You're rather in spirit. If, in fact, God's spirit is dwelling in you. Now, if someone doesn't have the anointed king's spirit, that is Jesus' spirit, that's Christ, the anointed king, if someone does not have that spirit, they're not part of him. They don't want to be part of him because they certainly would give them that spirit if they sought it out. But if the anointed king is in you, now notice it's not just the anointed king's spirit, as it was in the first phrase, but the anointed king himself, Christ himself, Jesus himself. If the anointed king himself is in you, although the body is mortal, it's dying because of the impact of sin, the presence of the Spirit is life itself because of God's faithful righteousness. God, the righteousness of God that has fulfilled God's promises that he's made to his people and is now fulfilling them in this new kind of relationship that he's made possible. Now, if the spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead, who's that? That would be God the Father, I guess we would say. The Spirit of God, but not just simply said as the Spirit of God, but tied specifically to Jesus' resurrection. If the spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead is dwelling in you, and that's the gospel, if you hold on to that gospel, then he who raised the anointed king, using anointed king or Messiah, whatever, in place of Jesus now, then he who raised the anointed king from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies. You're on the way to death right now. But if you know that this that God has done is real and true, if you're living in it, if you're open to it changing your life, drawing you in, then that raising of Jesus from the dead becomes the very raising of you from the dead. If the spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead, then the God who raised the anointed king from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit, who is making his home within you. Is that really going on inside me? What about you? Is it going on inside you? Is God's Spirit making his home in you? The Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, the Spirit of God that raised the anointed king from the dead, that triumphed over death itself, that is dwelling in you. And I am getting old and I'm very mortal. No, I'm not. The Spirit of God that raised Jesus from the dead, I truly believe, dwells in me, dwells in you, dwells in all of us. So that changes everything. He's making his home within us. So then, brothers and sisters, we don't owe any obligation to the flesh. We think about our flesh as though it's so much who we are that I can't get away from it. It's the way I am. It's who I am. And it's like I just have to go on with it because I can't break. It's so strong. He says, No, you don't. You don't owe any obligation to that flesh to keep on living lives determined by flesh. For if you're with your its own little ways of making the world center around me, my gods or little gods that I make, and so forth. For if you're living a life determined only by flesh, you're only in the process of dying. But if you join with the Spirit in condemning to death, this goes back to what Paul said in the very first verses of the 8th chapter, that God has condemned not sinners, but sin itself, condemning to death the sinful practices of the body. you're going to truly live. So Paul is leading us to experience the power of what God has done. What God has done in Jesus, in all of that Jesus did, and in raising Jesus from the dead, because in that is the conquest of death, and the Spirit. He wants Jesus and the Spirit to open to us and to empower us to step into God's realm, to know its reality, and to that beautiful life that God has created for us. So if we enter that truth, that reality of God's grace, remember we talked about the Spirit of truth when we were talking about John 14. If we enter that truth, God's reality, the reality of God's grace, then a new life flows out from that. The whole of God, the Spirit, Jesus, Father, all participate in our life. That's the reason that this flesh, in spite of the fact that it's just so real, and it is real, doesn't have the power to determine my life, to limit the way I see reality, the way I see the world, the way I see you. I don't have to just think of you as how I can use you, but I can value you completely, love you. We are actively engaged in the character of our own lives, what our lives are about. We're never compelled to become something, but rather are engaged in this. The limits and distortions of flesh never go away. They keep working at us, but the Spirit helps us to see more, and it leads us into a genuine life. As the children of God were created to be. It's often, it often talks about the fact that, you know, the story in Genesis of they were created in the image of God, that God created them in that image, but God's image sort of gets lost. And it's in this process, as Paul talks about it, and it's talked about in the New Testament in general, of looking at Jesus, looking at him, who he is, what he does, and having that Spirit working within us in that engagement, that we receive again the image of God. And so Paul speaks of being led step by step by the Spirit, like Israel was in the wilderness. And in the next verses, verses 14 through 17, he kind of echoes things from the story of Israel. For all, beginning with verse 14, again on the front side of your sheet, for all who are led through life by God's Spirit are God's sons and daughters. Just like Israel was described as the son of God, Israel was freed from Egypt and went into the wilderness as God led them with the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud and so forth. You are God's sons and daughters, for you didn't receive a spirit of slavery to turn back into that slavery like sometimes the Israelites wanted to do. Turn back again toward fear. But you received a spirit who empowers our adoption as God's children. The spirit of adoption. Our adoption as God's children. And in that spirit, in whom we cry, Abba, Father, with that intimacy and that freedom that comes of belonging in God's family. Paul says, the Spirit himself is bearing witness with our spirit. Yes, we definitely have our spirit, but the Spirit of God, the Spirit himself, God himself, is bearing witness with our spirit that something has happened that we could not bring about, that we can't make ourselves children of God, but we are children of God. Now, if we're children, he says, woohoo! What happens when you're a child of somebody? You're heirs. Heirs who belong to God's family. I mean, it literally is just simply heirs of God or heirs belonging to God. Heirs of God. Ooh, what do heirs do? They inherit, right? That's the point of saying somebody's an heir. What does God own that you, Lynette, are going to inherit? What does God own? What belongs to God? This bottle of water? Oh, yeah, sure. These flowers? Yeah, absolutely. This paper that I printed stuff on? Sure. You? Oh, yeah. Me? Yes, indeed. The mountains and 1,000 mountain ranges? Yes. Every beast that's on them? Yes, indeed. The oceans and the deepest trenches, the galaxies and the subatomic particles, everything belongs to God. And so you are heirs of God, heirs who are part of God's family. And you are fellow heirs. This is almost, for those of us who are Christians and think about Jesus a lot, this is almost even more, that you're fellow heirs with Jesus, the anointed king. Amazing. Just, you know, I mean, you can just go round and round in your mind trying to get your mind around that and not to blow your brain, not to blow your ego up too much, but to realize what a gift it is. But then there's that last little if that's there in the last part of that verse 17. If indeed, we're suffering with him so that we may also be glorified with him. Jesus, the one who combines human and God in one being, when he comes to the earth that he created, he was not received, or he was received with blows and with crucifixion. Now, Paul is not expecting every member of the Roman church to be crucified by any means. But as it so happens, as we've mentioned before, it was about 10 years after this that a good large percentage of the people who read this letter got murdered by the Roman army under Nero after the fire in Rome. The Spirit creates, as he says, boldness, not fear. The Spirit lives in us, creating confidence with God, so that even in the face of suffering, we may also know that that larger reality, that larger picture, is in the realm of God and is a glorification like Jesus with that's beyond anything that we can imagine. So we're with Jesus. We're sharing in his suffering. We experience it. And for most of us, it's limited in some way. For some, like Paul, who ended up getting his head chopped off, it's pretty radical. We experience it. We empathize with others. But the thing that is interesting as Paul follows on from this is that he links it to the transitoriness of all creation. All of the world is wonderful and beautiful and all of that, but as the poet says, things fall apart. And things go downhill and they break and turn into disappointment. Verses 18 through 23. Paul says, for I don't consider that the sufferings of our time right now are worthy to be set beside the glory that's going to be revealed for us. For the eager expectation of all creation is breathlessly awaiting the revealing of the sons and daughters of God. That's hard for, that's one of the harder things for me to get my mind around, that the whole of creation is linked to you, to me, to all of us. The whole of creation. For this, the creation was subjected to vain transitoriness, not by its own will, but because of the one who subjected it, based on a hope that even the creation itself will be set free from slavery, the slavery of its corruption, into the freedom of the glory that belongs to the children of God. For we know that all creation is sighing with us and suffering pains of childbirth with us until this moment. And not only that, but also we ourselves, we're stuck here too. We ourselves, as we possess the first fruits of experiencing the Spirit, we're also still sighing in ourselves as we're eagerly awaiting our full adoption as God's children, our redemption of the body from slavery, like Israel again being brought out of slavery. Notice how Paul, and he talks about this, personifies all of creation. All of creation is in and with us. It's longing with us. It's longing in us, and it longs for more. It longs for renewal. It longs for a good that's beyond imagination. And we embody and express, and in relationship with the Spirit, we have within us that longing for the good. We're part of the whole creation of God, the physical world that God invented and that God loves. God does not forsake the physical world. He doesn't just blow it away. He renews it. He recreates it, as Paul is describing it here. That's what resurrection is about, as he says. This resurrection that has been done in Jesus, that the Spirit is working on in us, is also something that all of creation shares in. Now, I don't know exactly what that means. I don't know how. I don't know when. Nor do you, even if you try to tell me that you do. But the Spirit in us is a first step in that whole recreation. It links us to the size of all creation, every person, everything that's experiencing the vanity, the transitoriness of life. Our own life with the Spirit is part of God's recreation from all the brokenness, injustice, pain, suffering, loss, and decay of the world. And so Paul says, beginning in verse 24, as we get toward the end, we got to quickly get there. For in hope we were saved. Now when a hope is seen, it's no longer hope. For who hopes for what they already see? But if we're hoping for what we don't yet see, then we're eagerly waiting for it with real fortitude. In the same way, the Spirit is helping just where we're weak, in that ignorance and that transitoriness. For we don't know what we should pray for, what's really needed. But the Spirit himself is interceding on our behalf with sighs that can't be put into words. Now the one who searches the hearts knows the Spirit, knows the Spirit's very way of thinking, because it's in accord with God's reality that he intercedes on behalf of God's people. And we know that for those who love God, he works with them in all things toward what's good. For those who are called according to God's purpose. It might take a couple of readings through Romans 8 to get all of it together and for you to understand everything completely. It's taken me about 700 or 800 readings through it to get anywhere close to it. But it's worth the challenge. We experience life on so many levels. We're part of the physical world. We're part of communities of people. We're people with deep emotions, for example, sometimes good, sometimes bad. We're people that are capable of intelligence and understanding. We're people of creativity and longing for beauty and all of that. In all of these things, we know that there is more. Beyond anything we've reached, there's brokenness that needs repair. There's new that needs to be explored. The Spirit brings that more vividly into our lives. And so we live in hope. But a hope for something that's beyond ourselves also reveals our limits, our weakness. The Spirit connects our weakness to God's future, what God is doing and where God is going. And that's what Paul is talking about when he talks about the fruit of the Spirit. It's not some fancy thing. It's down to earth, the character of life. The fruit of the Spirit, as Paul describes it in Galatians 5, is simple, just a series of words. But the words help us reflect on a quest for life that's already part of God's new creation. The beauty of love, joy, peace. What's the rest of them here? Let's see if we could read them all together. Love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. All of those are, as we said before, they're descriptions of God. They're descriptions of the heart of God, of the life of God. And they're not virtues to be achieved. They're not requirements to meet. But we are nevertheless very much involved in it. They are the organic outcome of the shared life between God and us through the Spirit. As you read each of them, you think about them at all, you realize that they imply a community of people like us here today, a people together on this journey with God. Every one of our lives here is personal and distinct as God wants it, but with mutual support for each other and help in the process, different as we are. They express God's heart and character that we see in Jesus, and we learn to live by that Spirit. Each one of them is wonderful, but challenging. Just take love and get it into your life. Take peace and so on. A gift of more life as God's Spirit lives within us and leads us step by step by step. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our benediction song. Light of my journey, over
Jesus has said, I'll never forsake.